What are we up to today?
Today, we are answering the people's questions from the comments in YouTube. The first question is, what is the amount of labor involved in replacing a microinverter versus a string inverter if one fails?
Great question. Mm. That's a really, really good question. So that question, and who is it from, Dan?
Todd.
From Todd. Todd, thank you for your question. What is the amount of labor in replacing a string inverter versus a microinverter? Well, you'd probably split that into two sections, right? Because you've got to remember, doing a warranty claim, which I'm going to assume is what you mean, there's a lot of administration that goes with a warranty claim, actually. So, and I guess I'll show you both parts of the world. So a string inverter, firstly, you'd hope to have monitoring set up on the string inverter. Now, if the client has rung up and said, hey, you got to remember when a string inverter goes down as well, the client's lost their whole solar system. So they're going to be pretty annoyed. It's not like they've got some of their solar system still working unless they've got multiple string inverters, which is somewhat unlikely. You'll go to site, you'll actually test and diagnose. So what you're doing is you're testing the AC input to the inverter. You're also testing the DC input as well. There are a couple of other tests that you do to make sure, A, that there's no fault with your panels, and to make sure that you have a DC and an AC connection that is present for your inverter to work on. Now, most inverter manufacturers won't want you to pull apart the string inverter. They'll want you to just test and see. A lot of the time, if your inverter's failed, if it's not a complete bang, which if it is a complete bang, it's quite obvious because you can pull apart the front cover. There might be a blown capacitor, DC power stack. It could be a number of things that are very visually obvious. But most inverter manufacturers won't ask you to do that. If it hasn't fully gone bang, quite often they'll have an error code, you know. So back in the day, ABB inverters or Aurora inverters, they used to have a really common error code, which is scarred in my memory for life, EO31. And that was an AC relay failure, if I remember rightly. And so that's a tiny component in a string inverter, but it's enough to actually wipe the whole inverter out. And it wasn't replaceable. So you'd get a new inverter, you'd replace the whole inverter and get that client back up and running. So by the time the client calls in, I think it's really reasonable service to get to a client's house in a couple of days. It's actually, I'll take that back. It's fantastic service to get an electrician to the client's house within a couple of days. It is reasonable to be a week. You start getting longer than a week and you're kind of questioning what the solar company's priorities may be, or if they actually have a service department in-house. By the time you test it, you know, you might be looking at, it might only be an hour of labor. It could even be half an hour if you're a sharp electrician. If you've got a backdoor phone number to the inverter manufacturer, you'll be able to get through to them a lot quicker. If you've built a relationship and some rapport with the inverter manufacturer, you'll usually push the warranty claim through pretty quickly, if you're a respected company particularly. If it's your first or second one, maybe you won't have the same level of relationship and they'll want you to do some more testing. Once all that's done and you've lodged a warranty claim, I'm pretty confident to say it's a week to 2 weeks for an inverter to actually be shipped to your office or to that client's address. Now, good service would be that once it arrives, you would take it pretty much immediately in the next couple of days at least, and you'd reinstall that inverter. So an inverter changeover, an hour. It depends on the type of inverter, I guess, and the brand of inverter. Some of them could be as quick as half an hour. Some of them might be an hour. Some of them could even be 2 hours. It really depends on if they've given you a like-for-like inverter or if they've given you the newer model. The reason a newer model would take longer is because you've got to pull the bracket off the wall and remount a new bracket. For example, the SolarEdge SE5000s, which we had a lot of failures with. They were a 2017 model, say. They had a little really poorly designed bracket. It was actually two brackets that you had to put a template on a wall, and two brackets had to line up perfectly with each other for the inverter to hook on. If you've just got one bracket, it's way quicker. You know, you just have to get that bracket level, get it in the right spot, and you're good to go. So it really, really depends on the type of inverter. And then it's internet connection, because you've got to remember, when a string inverter fails, you're actually replacing the whole inverter. So you've got to reconnect the internet to the inverter. You've got to completely recommission the system. Now, optimistically, that could take 15, 20 minutes. But, you know, if it's your first or second time, or if you're not familiar with that brand of inverter, that could take actually a couple of hours. Now, let's just say the best case scenario is that you have a great relationship with, let's say it's a Fronius inverter, and everyone knows a Fronius inverter. They're a fantastic string inverter option. You get to site, you got a great relationship with Fronius, you get a unit sent out in about a week, so you maybe got an hour's worth of labor on the front end. You get a little bit of admin, just getting paperwork, getting the old inverter picked up as well. The benefits of a Fronius are is that they're really quick to change over. You can actually change over a Fronius in like 10 minutes, or 15 minutes, 20 minutes. And that's because the wiring is wired to the base plate, which is the bracket. So they're probably the quickest to change, actually. And you can recommission that and have that up and going in probably another hour, maybe half an hour if you're quite quick. Then you've just got to send the old inverter back to them and you're pretty good to go. So I reckon, all in all, there's at least 2 to 3 hours for a string inverter. The key is that over that 2 week period minimum, you've got zero energy being produced, right? Absolutely nothing. Not a single kilowatt hour will be produced because your inverter's failed. Your panels are sitting there doing nothing. Now let's verse that to the Enphase microinverter system, which is obviously at Penrith Solar, it's the only thing we install. We have not done a string inverter in the last 3 to 3.5 years. We've only done Enphase, and there are tons of reasons why, and this is a really good example. If a microinverter fails on an Enphase microinverter system, we really strive hard to have all of our systems connected to the internet at all times. Now, I'm sure the string inverter manufacturers do as well. It's really, really good practice. And in some ways, it's actually a legal requirement that the client has an earth fault alarm, which means an alarm of some sort that lets them know if the system has a failure, a particular type of failure. So having them connected to internet is a really good practice, as well as it keeps the software up to date at all times. And of course, you have your monitoring on your phone. So at PSC, we push really hard for everyone's internet to be connected at all times. Now, the big advantage, there's two huge advantages here. First thing, if you've got a micro down and you've got 20 panels, you're only 5% of your system down. So your system actually keeps working like usual. It's just that one panel's not producing energy. Now, is it annoying? Yes, it is. Of course it is. You've got a micro inverter down. You bought a product with a 10, 15 year warranty. We want it to be working at all times. But the good news is it's not the end of the world and you'll still be producing kilowatt hours to the point where you almost won't even notice that one micro is out. The second really big advantage with Enphase is that we are able to do a 100% remote warranty claim. Now, why are we able to do this and string inverter manufacturers sometimes are not? Well, the reason we're able to do this is because the microinverter is only responsible for one panel. So if we've got data on that microinverter, we can actually sit there and diagnose, okay, was it a panel failure or was it a microinverter failure? You've got to remember, with a string inverter, before the client, before someone gets to site, they don't know if it's a panel failure or a inverter failure just yet. So they've still got to work that out before they diagnose the failed inverter. With a microinverter failure, it's actually really easy to work out. It's like, okay, is the panel operational? Is there DC coming into the microinverter? Or is the microinverter the problem that's failed? If the microinverter is what's failed, and to be fair, it's 50-50. 50% of the time it'll be a panel, 50% of the time it'll actually be a microinverter. Now, it's good for both. If it's a panel, we can get the data straight off the Enphase portal. We can send it to the panel manufacturer, whether that be SunPower, Qcells. We can say, hey, this panel very obviously has a blown bypass diode, or this panel is very obviously failed. Send us a new one under warranty, and they will do that just off that data without us even going to site, providing they get the old panel back, of course. Now, if it's a failed microinverter, the same thing is true. We are able to completely get a new microinverter sent to us from Enphase, and what we do is a one-stop warranty claim. So that means we only go to site once. Now, to be really fair, when we are doing a microinverter replacement, we do have to get on the roof. So we'll shut the system down, we'll throw up a ladder, we'll jump on the roof with a harness on, with our new microinverter, we'll pull a panel up, we'll take the old microinverter out. You gotta remember it's plug and play. We don't actually really need any screwdrivers or pliers. And we'll install the new microinverter. Now we need to take the serial number off the new microinverter, we relay the panel, and we jump back down. We then turn the system back on. big advantage with Enphase, because the whole system didn't blow, we don't have to recommission on site. So we're going to save ourselves 15, 20 minutes, half an hour, depending on the inverter manufacturer, on site. It may or may not have taken longer to install the new microinverter. Depends how good you are at installing microinverters. I'd say it's probably a pretty similar time to jump up, replace one micro, as it is to replace a string inverter. But there is one little bit of work left to do at the office for a microinverter company that a string inverter company doesn't have to do. And it's at your benefit that it's done. And that is when we get back to the office. So from the time we leave site, that microinverter is up and running. We need to jump into the portal. We need to retire the old microinverter serial number and replace it with your new serial number of microinverter. This means that it will show up on your monitoring exactly the same way that your old microinverter did. So all in all, there are less site visits for an Enphase failure. The time required is probably pretty similar. I would actually argue that Enphase has less time required, but the most important fact is for that 2 weeks or thereabouts that it took to get a new micro or a new string, you were producing 0 kilowatt hours of a string system and you're producing 95% with an Enphase system. Now, more micros that you have beyond 20, that percentage drops from 95 to 96 to 97. If you had 100 microinverters and one failed, you are 1% down. So plenty of kilowatt hours. In fact, I would go to the extent of saying that a failure of a string inverter, that gap in energy that you're going to lose for a couple of weeks or worst case scenario, a couple of months, could actually pay the difference for the difference between a string inverter system and a microinverter system. Now, the variable is how long did it take the client to realize that their string inverter had actually failed. At Penrith Solar, we are quite proactive with our monitoring and we do have a full-time service department, which means that we are actively looking for failures and the algorithms that are set up in the Enphase and Lighten portal will tell us if there is a failure. Some string inverters do a similar thing and have a similar feature. However, a lot of string inverters actually don't. And as a client, you may not know until you get a power bill. The same is true with Enphase. If you get Enphase installed through a company that doesn't have a service department or doesn't really care about the performance of your system afterwards, you might have the same problem. With Penrith Solar, you'll have peace of mind knowing that someone's always looking over your system, even when you're not. So, all in all, I would say the warranty process is far smoother with an Enphase microinverter system, and the downtime for you is almost non-existent. So, for that, Dan, I would say Enphase certainly wins hands down every day of the week. Zero questions asked.
Mm. Awesome. I'm glad you covered the site visits, because the question I had as you were talking was the site visit to simply diagnose the problem. You know, from the client's perspective, all they know is that their system is down.
Yeah.
Right? They don't know if it's panel or inverter.
Yep. No idea.
You've got to, you know, troubleshoot that and identify that. And then obviously it's another site visit. If it isn't a warranty claim though, then it's no longer a question of what's the issue. It's just get my system online.
Yes.
So
yeah, which can sometimes be a full ripoff.
Yeah.
If it's an old, very old system and it's like, cool, you can replace this one panel, but in 6 months' time there'll be another one and another one and another
one.
You may replace it. But fortunately, Dan, we're in a time right now where every panel on the market has 25, 30 year warranty. There are a lot of products out there still in warranty. String inverters, even if they're a 5 year warranty, like people still do have a lot of warranty to go. So most of these things are warranty challenges that we're seeing at the moment. People with 10-year-old systems, maybe they're on the 60-cent feed-in. What we find is their system is actually so small and inadequate and unfortunately taking up the best real estate on the client's roof space that they naturally want to take it off and replace it anyway, because you now have 450-watt panels. Back in the day, 2015, we were doing 220s, 230s, you know, 2016, we're doing 250s.
Yep.
So there's not 200 watts in that same, very similar footprint of panel.
So in summary, the labor involved to replace a micro versus string sounds to be quite similar.
Yes.
The process and how it affects the client's production and energy bill in the meantime is very, very different.
Yeah, it's interesting because like questions like that do come from sometimes electricians or people being a bit cheeky.
Mm.
And what I like, people are like, oh, but you got to throw a ladder to replace an inverter. Cool story. What do? Every day we do 14 installs a day. Guess how many ladders are up today? Mm. We work on roofs and in roofs. That's our job. That is our actual job. We work with electricity and heights. So yes, you got to throw a ladder to replace the microinverter. That's why anyone can't do it. And thank goodness they can't.
That's right.
Yeah.
Awesome. All right. Thank you. Thanks for your question, Todd.
Hey, thanks, Toddy.
Cheers.
Uru.